Well, hello friends, this is Pete, ham radio call sign K7PP, and as you might have surmised, we're out here in the shop again. And I'm working on an old Hammarlund HQ-170-A. I've been using this one for a couple of years. I went through it pretty well and aligned it and tested it and replaced the tubes and recapped part of it and basically brought her back to life. The unit actually basically works very well. But I'm kind of going to spend a little bit of time on the aesthetics. In order to repair this problem with the yellow dial, as you might be able to see, I've got to take the front panel off, and that's what I'm doing today. And we'll kind of let you follow along with that. Essentially, of course, taking all the knobs off is one thing. But one thing that you might be careful of when you're taking the knobs off are the pointers. These little pointers typically can be found on the vernier tuning and also on the slot adjustment. There's two of them. And be real careful taking them off that you don't damage them. They're kind of pressed on, and just the tension of the pointer's mounting keeps it in place. So anyway, just kind of keep an eye on it and just start taking screws out, and we'll kind of follow this along. And I specifically wanted to show you something that a lot of the 170 and 170As suffer as far as the right-hand dial, and we'll get to that here shortly. Continuing on, before you take the front panel off, you're going to have to take some of the front mounting screws out. You'll see there's one here, and this one is kind of an attachment to a L-bracket that is part of the front assembly that holds the bottom of the case in place. So you kind of want to just kind of be careful of that when you take it out. All of these here, here's the next one up here on top, have a spacer in between. If you look very carefully, you'll be able to see a spacer on the other side here. And pulling this out immediately, the spacer's free, and it's free to roll under whatever, which is what usually happens to me. So anyway, when you're taking the front panel off, beware. And as I mentioned, when you get in here and take this L bracket off, you might also notice that the terminal strip, it's kind of hard to see, but the terminal strip that's associated with this is also held to ground by the front panel screw. And this has also got some resistors that are part of the volume control circuit. So you got to make sure when you put this thing back that everything is really snug, otherwise just moving the case around will give you lots of noise in your audio. You might even have a microphonic issue too. So when this gets put back on, it gets put back on snug. Okay, there we go. Now that I've got the front panel off this, I can tell you right now I never have had it off before. So might as well. We'll get this puppy cleaned up really good and really give the front panel a good scrubbing and soaking. Let's see if we can't get this back in good shape. As far as cosmetics go, I can see that it looks pretty good as far as the paint and the nomenclature on the panel. So it should clean up really well. Anyway, eventually this puppy will find itself a new home, and hopefully it will occupy a prized spot on the operating bench if it's not too ugly. So that's the idea today. I was going to talk to you about the dials. Now, the dials are really kind of flaky. I mean, as far as the design goes, I mean, they work all right, but the windows that you see are tandem windows, and when you tune one, they both tune at the same time. They've got a little wire connection between these pulleys here, so when one turns, the other turns. And They're basically showing the frequency readout of all of the different bands. It's just done on two different wheels, unlike the 180 where the wheel is a band spread. This one has a fixed veneer tuning here for the band spread, if you want to call it that. It's not really a general coverage receiver, so there is no need for a quote-unquote band spread. But the veneer tuning allows you to tune or warp the IF a little bit one way or the other, up to 3 kilohertz in either direction. And so it makes tuning critical stations like on 10 meters really easy. Now you'll see this bar here. When this bar moves, when you calibrate, the calibrate wheel is right here on this lip. It's part of the front panel right here, and it moves this wheel or this window, and that is tandem connected to the other. So let's see if I can explain what it was I was talking about when I said that we were having some issues with the right-hand dial. I guess the best way to explain it is, if you look very closely, you'll see that when these move in tandem, the two dials, that the pointer, or the graticule, is basically up and straight up and down. In other words, when this one moves to the left, this one moves to the left. When this one's straight, this one's straight, and so forth. What happens is that right down here in the hub where this bar is connected, over the years, the plastic starts to wear, and the hole in the center there becomes larger and larger. And then what happens is that the pointers don't point in the same direction anymore. And I'll give you an example of that. So here is a Hammarlund 170, and this is an older unit that I've gone through and cleaned up, and I actually had the front panel off of this one and gave it a good scrub down. And of course it's been aligned and tested and all that stuff, so it's a really good working receiver. But look at the pointers. You notice the pointer on the right is to the left of the pointer on the left. So you can see it pretty well here if I move this calibration. You can see that they still move together, but the standoff is different. The one on the left is certainly not corresponding to the straight up and down to the one on the right. So a new plastic lens, I guess you'll call it, for the right side with the appropriate size hole is probably the only way to go, unless some kind of a bushing can be installed. And I'm not going to try and do that on the one in the garage because of the yellow stain on the plastic. So we're going to try and have a new one manufactured. So back out here in the shop again, and the next endeavor will be to remove these plastic lenses. And I'm going to measure them and maybe even scan a lens on my scanner. And then I can send it to the manufacturer of a lens that is an aftermarket, and hopefully he'll be able to duplicate this, and we can replace this yellowed out lens. The actual wheel itself is okay. It's clean, but the lens is what's got to go. And in some cases, a lot of the Hammarlunds end up with a discolored or yellow wheel, and that gets a little bit more dicey. I don't know of anybody that makes those. So there you go. I'm going to do another video once we get the new plastic lens in and reassemble,
And in the meantime, I'm going to clean and scrub the front panel and put everything aside and wait for the new part to arrive. And then we will put everything back together and then do another alignment. So that's the plan. Thanks for looking. Thanks for your interest. This is Pete, K7PP, Grace Harbor County. Hope to hear you guys on the air.